Welcome to this very early morning, on the record, conversation with Prime Minister Romano Prodi of Italy. Please turn off your cell phones and other similar devices. We have a tight schedule. The Prime Minister has to depart at 8:45.
I don't know.
They tell me.
I am a package.
He's had a busy time. He met with President Bush yesterday, and today he's speaking at the General Assembly and doing many things and then flying off tonight to Rome. And, of course, he comes here from China. We'll talk about that perhaps in a moment. Let me begin with an episode that I think might be interesting for some of you. In the spring of 1979, when I was ambassador to Italy, I found that there was a brilliant young economist, 39 years old, that was young to me, as Minister of Industry in the Andreotti government, and I invited him to lunch. The morning of our luncheon, it was announced on radio that Andreotti had reshuffled his government and this brilliant young man was out of a job.
Don't do it.
That won't happen again. So he called me and said, did you hear the news? I said, yes, I did. He said, you know, I'm not anymore a minister. I said, I know. He said, well, you don't want to see me for lunch then because you're ambassador. Why? I'm nobody. I said, Romano, come on. I'll make a prediction. I know you're depressed at the moment, but one day you will be Prime Minister of Italy. And he said, no, impossible. I said, you will be Prime Minister of Italy, I promise you. Well, when he became Prime Minister...
My answer was, is a menace.
It was a threat to you. Well, in 1996, of course, he became Prime Minister. And I think historians give him credit in those 2 years that he had as Prime Minister in 1996-98, laying the economic foundations through courageous policy of Italy's qualification to enter the Eurozone. He went on, as you know, to be president of the European Commission, where he presided over the successful introduction of the Euro, the enlargement of the European Union. Now he comes back for the second time as Prime Minister, and one of the things he does early in this new assignment is something very courageous. He offers 2,500 Italian troops for Lebanon. And Shimon Peres put it very well when he said, without Italy's initiative, at a time when other countries, such as France, were backing away, without Italy's initiative, Resolution 1701, which helped put an end to the fighting in Lebanon, would have remained a piece of paper. So, Romano, you have many friends in this room who honor you, and we're very pleased that you're taking time out of your busy schedule to be with us. Now, having softened you up, I'm going to ask you a couple of hard questions. Maybe not as hard as Charlie Rose did last night, but different. The first has to do with the prospects of your government. Here you are. You won the closest election in Italian history. I think the margin was 0.1% of the votes. You have a 2-vote majority in the Italian Senate. You have 9 political parties in your government, 2 of them communist parties. Your opponent, Mr. Berlusconi, announces that he's going to bring your government down as soon as he can. And yet you have an ambitious agenda which you've set, including making Italy more competitive, reducing the excessive budget deficit, restoring competitiveness in service industries. You have 5-year term, which you say you're going to be able to fulfill despite this fragile situation. Italy is a country of miracles, but how can you do this?
Well, I divide the answer in 2 parts. First, in all the democracy, you win for very few votes. You know, I am... if I am not wrong, I am in the United States here. You know, and so please don't speak about slim majority. But what is bad is that with the previous law, and Berlusconi was in the government with this very small majority, but for 5 entire years with big majority in the lower and higher chamber, in the Senate, with the previous law, I should have a comfortable majority. He changed the law a few months before the elections, just to avoid a defeat, because the forecasts were more in my favor than the results, to be honest. But anyway, it so happens the last 2 weeks of the campaign, they were a shelling on tax cuts, miracles, and so on. So I am unable to make miracles, you know. So it's this is my limit, you know. But the second part of the answer is very clear. I've been 4 months in the government, and even this morning, you know, we have a slim majority, but we have a majority. Even if 3 of my senators are here in the UN, we got 4 votes majority in the Senate this morning. We have a strong discipline, but to pass from the parliament situation to the real political situation, my conviction is clear. If I go on with reforms, I go on for 5 years. If I step down or if I slow down, I fall. This was when we decided the liberalization of few sectors of Italian economy in the service sector. It went
pharmacies, taxis,
taxis, accountants, notaries, lawyers.
Notaries.
It went well because everybody knows that we need reforms. The Italian problem is reforms. And the previous government, they had a fantastic majority, and they didn't change anything. Well, they changed only, laws in favor of the prime minister or his friends. You know, and if I show to run the country in favor of a majority of people, I can go on 5 years. Certainly, it's not easy because you have 9 parties and you have you are always half prime minister and half a social worker. if you read Chris Patten wrote a book about the European Commission. He said, look, the same style of government I had in Brussels. The commissioners, they were very visible with a strong autonomy. And so after a couple of years, they cooperate together with the government. This is, of course, the style of government you need when you have this slim majority, but you can do a lot of things.
You're famous as a bicycle rider. It's like riding a bicycle. If you slow down, you fall off. So you have to pedal very hard.
Well, good.
You have, right direction.
You have not to fight in the right direction, and always.
Okay. Foreign policy. During the campaign, you said something which struck me as very interesting. I quote, this is in relation to the United States. To a friend, one must say what one thinks, when there is agreement and when there is not. The United States is served by this kind of ally and not the other type. Silvio Berlusconi gave support to President Bush across the board. He was even quoted once of saying, I will support President Bush's policies even before I know what they are. That may be apocryphal, I don't know. But
No.
He said that. Yeah, okay. You're... your approach is you're known as a great friend of the United States, but you've said, I'm going to tell the United States when it's right and when I think it's wrong. You met with President Bush yesterday. How has the administration reacted to this new approach in Italian foreign policy, which puts more emphasis on Europe and on the Middle East and the Mediterranean? Has this made your relation more difficult, or are you happy with the way it's begun?
Declaration. You know, when I met Bush in St. Petersburg, he told very clearly in front of everybody, I understand that you leave from Iraq. I should have been surprised if you have not, because you gained the election on this platform. I know you are clear, loyal, coherent, and so let us go on with our cooperation. On the facts, I 5 years president of the European Commission, never so good relation with the United States. Galileo, anti-terrorism, I can list anti-dumping agreement, I can list hundreds of agreements we had with the United States. Not Iraq, because, you know, I'm not an expert on Middle East, but I know very well the tense of the situation, the change, you know. You don't recognize the countries. If you go to Tunisia now, you see women with the scarf that they never had, you know, everywhere. You feel the situation when you live there. And so I was opposed to the Iraqi war, that's all. And I think that peace in the future is the same thing I told in China, you know, so, but this approach with China makes something against U.S. No, Europe and U.S. and U.S. must go together, otherwise all the balance in the world will be devastated. But I think that mistakes are mistakes, and terrorism is not, you know, the situation of terrorism is not certainly better off now than before the war in Iraq. The emergence and the role of Iran is because there is a change in the power situation in the area, and I can list a lot of consequences that I consider negative, not only for Europe, but for the United States. And this has been my position, and I never changed it. And, you know, now I am a little more confident in the sense that in the Lebanon, you have, thanks God, an agreement between U.S., Israel, Jordan, all European countries, you know, and it's the first time since many, many years that you have this change and common action. And so I think I've done more with my position clear and coherent for the friendship between U.S. and Europe than many others who have told I shall follow the American administration before they speak, you know. I think that this has been, it's been a difficult situation, because for years I was shelled of anti-American. Luckily, I was teaching here, studied here, I worked here, you know. I know hundreds and hundreds of people that have responsibility, and so there could not be any misunderstanding, but then they told, yes, but the communists will, and they are not prevailing in my foreign policy. Now we are starting, because I think that the Lebanon, having in Lebanon all the great powers, you know, U.S., they have no troops, but they are active there. You have China. Russia will send not a big number of soldiers, but Putin told me that they were thinking to be there in some way. You have now a new situation from that you could start also thinking to the Israeli and Palestinian situation. and with a new dialogue and multilateralism. And that is what is important in this area. This is what I think, you know.
Some Americans still worry that a stronger, more united European Union will be a counterweight to the U.S. rather than a partner. You don't see a contradiction between the...
You have never been in China?
I have been in China.
You know, because... you know, when they say counterweight, it's, people don't... You know, they have no idea of the new world. What is now, you know, it's... I think that... Europe, if we have common sense, we stick together, you know, not counterweight. You need help, we need help, you know. Not because we want to counteract China, because I am working at China camps in the world community with a peaceful attitude, and the fact that they are in Lebanon is so important, you know, it's so important. But because in this world, to think that we can be a counterpart of the United States, it's, and that it is our interest to do that, is completely out of any historical perspective. You can do it, but it's a mistake, simply. And then if you take also, this is in economic terms, cultural terms, but if you take the military expenditure, even that, you find that is a complete nonsense.
The initiative you courageously took in sending those troops to Lebanon is deeply appreciated, but it involves risks, putting those men between Hezbollah and Israel. Exactly why did you do that? It was not an easy decision, surely. And some people say that the mandate and the engagement rules are ambiguous, and it's been criticized even within Italy. Why did you do it? Why did you take this decision?
It was an easy decision inside the government, you know. With the Minister of Foreign Affairs, with the Minister of Defense, there was the obvious unity and reaction. Well, we live in the Mediterranean. From here, you may see like spectators, you know, but I was telling Yete Duchero's show that last week there was a meeting in Sirte, Libya, of the African Union. I started 6 o'clock from Rome. I had dinner in Libya, and then I went to sleep to Bari. You know, we live there. That's a simple problem. And the Mediterranean is a time bomb. A time bomb. And you have to care about it. So I'm not only decided this mission, but I have already made a tour of my European colleagues who live in the Mediterranean area to try to have a new policy. When I was in the European Commission, I proposed it 3 times to have the Mediterranean Bank of Development. And the Northern Counter didn't want. It's completely justified, you know, because they are not Mediterranean countries. Then I proposed common universities and so on. Now, with France, Spain, Greece, Cyprus, Malta, and Germany and Austria, which are not Mediterranean, but they are very interested and forward-looking on these problems. We shall try to have a Mediterranean policy, active Mediterranean bank, in which there will be a board of equal members from south and north. Few university with the same number of students, south and north, professors south and north. If we don't do that, you know, there will be a collapse. But we are in the middle of the earthquake, falla, I don't know how it's called, fault line. We are in the fault line. So I have to take care about this policy. And I wonder that my predecessor, they didn't look at the situation, you know.
Use the term fault line, time bomb. The Pope made a statement recently that has caused tremendous outcry in the Islamic world. There's also been widespread criticism in the Islamic world for President Bush's reference to Islamo fascism. You want to comment on the whole question of how we address the Islamic world and what how we might change our rhetoric or
well, if you know the Islamic world, you understand that there are 100 or more Islamic worlds, and my strategy is, well, my pre let's say my starting point is that the moderates and people who want to live peacefully are the vast majority. My policy is to work on them, and dialogue and dialogue and dialogue and dialogue. And, you know, in Lebanon, till now, of course, I know the risk of our troops. You may have all the incidents, but when they arrived, everybody was happy. It was, you know, just because it was a clear message to the most part of the Lebanese people. But if you don't act, giving action, you will never increase the strength of the moderates and people who want to cooperate. This is why I'm so, you know, my obsession is Gaza. When you go there and you see the third generation born in the camp, and you see, this is why we have to solve this problem, you know, because this is a school of non-moderates, of extremists, you know. The same thing is the tension when you have a war in Iraq, you multiply people who are not moderate. And so all my political line that say, look, if there is a clash, we die. We die because, we everybody will use instruments that are for destruction without any limit, you know. September 11 was an example, but you can multiply them. If you have this policy of working and linking together, you may have solution. And the sensibility of a European, of a Mediterranean, and I was born in this situation. I was born in the middle of it. You know, this is why I think that the American should exploit more this loyal differentiation or specialization or. Because it's our job, it's our life.
With the victory of Hamas in the Palestinian elections, the United States and Europe cut off assistance to the Palestinian Authority. If they put together a unity government now, which includes Hamas, under what conditions should Europe and the U.S. restore funding to the Palestinians?
First of all, there are principles that guide my life. When a revolution is done, and when an election is won. Very simple, you know, but you know, with Iran, it was, I found for years straight, I found myself in Iran. Just before the revolution, and you know, everybody understood that we were close to a revolution, you know. And when the revolution came, it was not accepted. And it's clear case that you need a dialogue when you have a revolution, always, because a revolution means extremism. And if you don't accept the change, you never have a dialogue, and this was the history between Iran and U.S., you know, with horrible mistakes from both sides. But the starting point is, and when there is election, you have to accept the results of the elections in Algeria, in Palestine, and this is the rules, you know. And I found contradictory to push for election, and they say, oh, good, the result is not what I wanted, so I shall not accept. Because Hamas has won in Palestine for the strange ambiguity of Hamas. They are from one side terrorists, from the other side they run the hospital, they are close to the society. They are, as always, a very complex group of people. And so you have to divide this, otherwise you never have the result.
So if I understand, you would recommend to President Bush that we, United States, and you in Europe, talk directly to yeah. Hamas, to Hezbollah, and to Iran.
Yeah, and the coalition government is a good occasion to do that. If we go on, because, you know, they have, when you see tension among Palestinians, 5 killed and so on, and the situation is complex even among the Palestinians. You know, it's not, I'm describing too easily it, you know, but you have to work on this direction. Or look, which is the alternative? We'll go on another century in this situation. With a new prospect, supply and demand of oil that are the limit, you know. So the marginal supplier is now Iran, eh? And we have done everything to make them much, much, much powerful than before. This is a policy.
Before we open it up to the audience, one more question on China. You, if I'm not mistaken, you were in China 5 days, 5 different
yes.
cities,
yeah.
4 ministers you brought with you, and am I correct, 800 businessmen?
Yeah, correct.
800?
Yeah, not big businessmen because the culture of middlemen.
Yeah, small, middle-scale enterprises.
But they were, what? You know, each of one, a few hundred million euro.
Why this visit? What was the purpose? What did you achieve?
You know, because... Look, you like or not, China is China. It's the new protagonist of the world. 1.3 billion people. 2 figures growth year by year for already 14 years, and then they will go on. I know China since a lot of time. I know all the leaders, and I follow step by step the change that are much deeper than anybody thinks. This society is changing. It's 2 years, in the last 2 years in China. You talk about social situation, about disparities, about the collapse of the health system. You couldn't do that before. You couldn't do, you talk about human rights, capital penalty.
You talk to them about human rights?
We have talked about human rights, of course. And the Chinese, they say, look, we are 1.3 billion people with terrible heritage. You know, and, you know, this was not possible. I repeat, I follow China since 20 years, almost yearly. Only, well, I don't know the country, but only in official, I can give you which is the Prime Minister, President of the Republic, and the main minister behavior. And the country is absolutely new. You know, you visit a campus of 30,000 students, with each student his... lives in the college, each professor lives in the college, and this in 2-3 years. And so this will be the Asia century. We are talking about China because I came from China with a different characteristic. We could do the same analysis with India. February, I go to India. And the second reason why I went to China is because my government has broken all the good contact with China and simply enhancing the trade problem. That is difficult. I also discussed about dumping, about trademarks, about the patents, about that. But if you only complain about trade, you simply have the negative aspects of import and you have not the positive aspect of that. But I found China asking for dialogue with Europe in an unbelievable way. They do understand that in some way, not because of the market only, but because of the necessity of slowing, opening up of the society, must have a dialogue with Europe. And they asked me also to knowing my past, and because I went there a few times as president of the European Commission, to go on working on helping through Italy this. And for my country, is a clear policy. Italy is the gate of Asia. We are in the middle of the Mediterranean. And there are 5.5 days of navigation from our port to Rotterdam. And so I told the Chinese, look, we had, joking, but not joking, you know, there were European concessions in China, why not to have Chinese concession in Europe? To show the message of deep cooperation. But please, let us try to have a strategic mind, you know, here they are businessmen. You have a first phase, the biggest investment flow in world history, because here we always talk of fact that never happened in history. Europe, US, to China or India. Well, this will go on, half for export, half for internal market. The internal market part will increase because consumption now is moving, you know. It's remember the Japanese strategy 1.5 generation ago. That's clear. Second strategy, underestimated, understudied, underanalyzed inside US. Chinese investment in Africa and Latin America for oil, mainly for oil. I met in Tiananmen Square the Sudanese prime minister and so the others, you know, going up and down, and raw materials. And Latin American foodstuff, soya and corn, you know, and let's say second wave independence. Third wave is clear. Investment into US and Europe to accompany the big export is normal, you know, like US did, you know. Adapt production for the market, make specific research, all what you need in this case when the flow is so big. I want to participate to the third one. This is my clear, simple strategy, you know. Why? Because the disaster of Italy, because of a slow, let's say, strength of the government, because of the difficulties of the country, you know, I always repeated that Italy was the only country with the Berlin Wall inside the country, dividing one country and not two countries. You know, you have to be objective in your analysis. You know, the curtain wall was, the iron curtain was there. You know, but because of this reason and the internal struggle, we lost the American investments wave. They went all North Europe. We lost the intra-European investment. They went to Spain, to the new countries of the enlargement. But the enlargement was an historical necessity. I wanted, I did it, I pushed it because it was an historic. I don't want to lose the third wave, historical wave of investment. The Asian investment into US or Europe, that's all.
That's very eloquent and very interesting. Now let's open it up for questions here, gentlemen. Yes. Wait for the microphone and then kindly state your name and identification, who you are. Yes.
I'm David Braunschweig, Bear Stearns and Council on Foreign Relations. You just said that you would welcome foreign investment in Italy. Last Friday, the chairman CEO of the Italian telecom company resigned on allegations that your administration had meddled excessively in their plan to sell the last remaining mobile telecom unit to that's controlled by Italians to potentially foreign interests. An hour after his resignation, Neelie Kroes, the competition commissioner of the European Commission, was here at the Council, and she indicated how effective her action had been in other instances where there's excessive meddling, such as in Spain with the energy transactions. When asked about Italy, she said that she would look into it. How do you view these allegations of something that would apparently go against your desire to reform Italy and to open it to the world?
First of all, Italy is certainly open to the foreign investment, even in utility. You told we had four telephone companies, three have already been bought by foreign companies. So I don't think that we are an example of self-sufficiency. 30% of Italian energy market is owned by French and Spanish. And the banking system, two banks were bought by foreign banks. And I can go on, the distribution, supermarket, hypermarket are French and German mainly. So I can go on listing that. But let us go to telecom, because it's quite interesting, you know. I was called by Mr. Tronchetti Provera for an urgent meeting. I did it, you know, and he was, as I think, is not interfering, because he asked for it. He told also to the press about the meeting. It's not a detail, is an important detail. And we went to the meeting, and he told me about negotiation. Now is everything public with Murdoch. They say the negotiation go well, and we shall go on in exchanging some, let's say, news, content of the news with, the day after, he published a plan of the split of the mobile, of the fixed net, and a total strategy, and he didn't tell me one word about it. And simply he hinted that the government knew because of the meeting. Clear like that. And I simply told that I was surprised, and I used a very, I self-constrained, you know, because if you ask a meeting with the prime minister and you have a big plan already prepared and you don't tell anything to him, it's not a problem of interference. Is a serious problem of behavior. And this is what happened. And I've never criticized this plan. This will be examined. Of course, the opposition is making a big mess, and shall answer to the parliament coming back. But this is what happened, you know, and will be certainly clear in any details in the future. And then I ask you a question, you know. You think really that the prime minister has not the right, right is not the correct word, but is not a good polite habit to talk him about a decision that will concern the most important company of the country that has influence on education, information, everything. I think it's correct to tell him. And there was no decision interference message from the government on this subject.
So if Guido Rossi, who replaced Tronchetti Provera as chairman of Telecom Italia, goes forward with the plan to separate the mobile telephone from the fixed lines, and it is then offered for sale to a foreign company, your government would not object to that?
You have no instrument. I can be not happy, of course, you know, because I want my country open to purchases, mergers, acquisition from outside, but I am happy when this come from both sides, you know. You can't have a country in which you are always object of acquisition and never subject of acquisition. This is, I think that you understand, you know, that from the political point of view, you have a country lost. But I am engaged, and I always did to you the market, to use to respect the market instrument. You know, when the two among the biggest Italian banks they merged together, I didn't know it before the decision, but I was absolutely happy because Italy had a strong, an additional strong bank, San Paolo and Intesa Associated, that will operate in the international market with more efficiency. This is, I think this is a correct government reaction, you know. Before the common market, I should have intervened. After that, certainly not.
Next question, yes.
Jeff Laurenti at the Century Foundation. Of all the major Western countries, Italy appears most to have assimilated that 1960s exhortation, make love, not war. And the Rome government has indicated pretty clearly this deployment in Lebanon is not to be one of combating Lebanese militias, but rather to be a kind of energizing agent for a broader peace settlement. Let me ask, particularly with regard to Syria, which is right next to where your and the other UNIFIL troops are going to be stationed, the Labor Party in Israel had been floating the notion of opening negotiations with Syria, and the word came down from Washington, we don't want to hear it. Is the European Union going to be pressing to open negotiations on that front, as well as on the Israeli-Palestinian track? And to what extent will you do that separately or hide behind, not hide behind, but rely on Solana and the EU to handle it on behalf of all the European countries?
No, I didn't understand the last, sorry.
To what extent on the Israeli-Syrian, Israeli-Palestinian track will Italy be an agent in its own right now that it has leverage from the UNIFIL leadership, or will it be entirely behind Solana and it's the EU that will do all of this kind of business?
Well, to this last part of the question, I answer that we always act with Solana. I take also my initiative that I take. I never do them without telling to my European fellows. They say Solana, and sometimes Chirac, if the problem is concerning specifically something. But all what we have done was done with agreement with Europe, sometimes taking the initiative. Let us arrive the famous problem of the Syrian Lebanese border. When in my conversation, I called Assad in this case. He called me, but anyway, we were in contact. Also, this is another reason why, you know, you have experience in the Mediterranean area. It's, you know, Assad. I knew his father. You know, and I don't know how many of you have had meeting with Assad's father, because it was quite an experience, you know. I know, really, because the meeting, they never were less than 2 hours and a half. And in the first hour, you never could talk about problems more recent than 2,000 years. You know. And this was, and you know, this is Syria. And then I told him, look, I do understand that you don't want troops patrolling your border. But I think that in front of the international community, because I think that he has an attitude much more open than things, and will come out. I think that if you accept European civilian, not in uniform, not with arms, let's say fonctionnaire or technician on the border, will be helpful. We'll have a small message, but important for the international community. And we are going on, you know. The French were perplexed, Solana pushed it, and we are working, as is already known, in this direction. And I'm confident that we arrive to this. This is not a revolution, but you understand how important it is that there will be with night instrument to detect if there are weapons, to have some control, at least for the big things, you know. I am not telling you that no weapon will pass the Syrian border, but it is an enormous change. I am working together with them in this direction, but I never did any of this special, not calling Solana and not telling Assad that I should have called Solana and Bush and talked to Bush and told everybody. And you know, I had in, with George Bush a clear conversation concerning my conversation with Larijani, and Larijani knew that I was telling to Bush, you know, this is. But what I perceived this summer is that people did never talk each other. But never. But can you believe to have a war without even knowing what is happening? This is the Middle East. This is my surprise about Middle East, by humans. I'm not talking as a politician. I'm talking as a human being here. But I say, look, but I never. Did you never call Assad? Never. Okay, never to say have an epic birthday? No. Well, you know, if this is politics, I don't know. You know, this is the humanity, you know, must be in some way protected in a more efficient way. This is what I think, you know.
Ralph?
Ralph Wilson's New York University. Mr. Prime Minister, a little bit earlier, you spoke about your strong support for enlargement, European Union. Do you support the entry of Turkey? And what do you think the possibilities of that happening in the next few years are?
My clear idea of enlargement, and this is what I exposed a few times, is, you know, in the beginning, the common doctrine was 10 years, 5 countries. I worked 10 countries, 5 years. Why you cannot stop? You know, when there is history is history. You have to react. This was ready, you know, and I think was a fantastic success. The biggest export of democracy never had in the world, you know, this is true. And in terms of economic growth, also in terms of change, it's Bulgaria and Romania, 1st of January, thanks God, this process will go on, because my fear was that it was stopped, because they were discussing about the so-called capacity, digestive capacity or absorption. And next step is the Balkans. We spend more money to keep soldiers in the Balkans than any possible European aid for the enlargement. Absorption capacity is that altogether they have 1% of European GDP. If you pour 5% to 1% is nothing. It's clear. So now Croatia, then Macedonia, that we prepared with a difficult coexistence between Serbs, Slavish and Albanians, you know, together, you know, this. Then I hope, you know, Serbia, Albania, don't forget what was Albania 12 years ago and the Italian mission to Albania. an episode that has been underestimated, but it was the first one, absolutely successful, risky. The country was going in disarray. We went, we helped, and we withdrew in 3 months without any casualty, because it was needed in the moment, you know. And then Turkey. Turkey is an enormous problem, not because of Turkey, but because of Europe. After the referendum, the European public opinion has clearly changed. Before the referendum, among the government, there was only Austria against. Now, it's clearly European public opinion is a moment of change. And so my opinion is that Turkey must come in, but with patience, long negotiation. Otherwise, if you want to push it too quickly, the process will break down. This is what I might. But in the meanwhile, what I proposed, the so-called ring of friends or neighbor policy, let's say that a European proposal to all the countries, this will need 20 years, 25 years, but it's important, all the countries from Russia to Morocco to share everything but institutions, let's say, not only market policy, but research, but not being part of the parliament, of the commission. And I hope that this process will start soon, because it's absolutely important. Russia is not eager to participate to that now, you know, but other countries, they are probably wanting to do it.
Stephen.
Mr. Prime Minister, Italy has long sought a permanent seat on the UN Security Council. Are you still seeking that, and do you have a candidate for the next Secretary General?
No, I have no candidate for the next General Secretary. Yesterday in the corridors there was this common mood for ASEAN, but I didn't get into that problem. For the Security Council, we are certainly for a reform, because the Security Council must represent the new world and not the old world. And it's time to start real negotiation, not to have these schemes, abstract schemes that don't, and they have no possibility to be implemented. So tonight we shall have a dinner with 60 states who share different opinion about that. Will be chaired by Musharraf and me, just to start the discussion about that. Not the discussion, the exchange of opinion, you know. But I think that very soon you must start a concrete discussion, because otherwise will be an ever-ending discussion, you know. I don't think that now my this part may be utopistic, but there is something wrong if you don't include the General Assembly in some big decision. Difficult, because you have almost 200 countries, but you feel that there is something wrong if you don't have a more vital role of the General Assembly. This is my opinion. But on this second point, it's difficult, you know. But you need it. You need it.
Perhaps it should be added that Italy is the sixth largest contributor to the UN budget,
yep.
Second to none in contribution to UN peacekeeping operations. It's going to be on the Security Council starting January 1st as a non-permanent member, but it had to wait something like 8 or 10 years, and perhaps it's not satisfactory to you that you get on the Security Council once every 8 or 10 years. You feel you should have a better a voice. Is that a fair conclusion? All right. Now, I have to ask the president here, President Haas, we're supposed to stop now, but do we have your permission to have 5 more minutes with
you?
Yes. Because this is so interesting.
A package is a package. You know.
I think there's such an interest, and a lot of people who still haven't had their question. This lady here has been very patient, then maybe one or two, and then Warren. Yes.
Thank you. Giovanna Weschler with Security Council Report. Stephen asked already part of my question, but most elected members of the Council usually come for the 2 years with a set of goals. Could you perhaps tell us, other than the Security Council reform, what will be your priorities when you are on the Council?
Well, the priorities, what I told before, you know. My analysis was strengthen the regional policy, I say Europe, but I worked also to help the African Union, you know, because I think that you can't go on with the African situation. You never talk about Africa when you talk about this, but Africa is a disaster, you know. And you need the regional, have these regional entities and so on and so on. You know, I do understand now that African Union troops in Darfur, they must be substituted because they are not efficient. You know, but the problem would be to make them efficient. You know, and in the long run, as President of the European Commission, I have given money for starting this African Union Security Force in order to conflict, and this is my main policy, reinforcing the General Assembly as I told before, and for the Security Council as I told, to try to shape it as the world is today. Absolutely difficult because you can't cancel the past, you know. I know that this is a difficult job, you know, but probably we'll end with simply an enlargement of the existing members, you know.
Maybe one last question from the back. The, I don't know your name, a woman there with her hand up. Yes. Okay.
Thank you. Karen Mills from Solera Capital. Italy is well known for picking certain industrial sectors or clusters or economic areas where it's been very successful in terms of competitiveness. And it's not just shoes, which we all appreciate, but it's also industrial parts. What lessons do you think the U.S. could learn from your competitiveness approach?
And this is a professor of industrial economics we're talking to. So that's how you started your career. So
I did my job, this job for 25 years, you know. Well, we have not very much to teach to others, you know, because our industrial structure is very peculiar. No, in the sense that we are specialized, you know. Of course, you have made in Italy, luxury goods, food, but this is not, well, it's important, but it's not. But our core industry is instrumental goods, not mass produced. If you have a machinery for, let's say, a robot that you produce in 10,000 will be Japanese. If you produce 1,000, it will be German. If you have 50 different robots making different things, will be Italian. You know, this is the type, to give you the type of skill that we have. And of course, we lost big companies. We are out of pharmaceutical. We are out of big energy power station production, either nuclear or traditional. We are out of sectors in which we were powerful a few years ago. But we are increasing in this middle-sized, very, very specialized instrumental good companies. And we have around, let's say, 2,000 companies between $500 million sales per year and $2 billion. You know, this is our, and that is not negligible strength. This makes Italy, in terms of manpower and added value, the second industrial country in Europe, you know, second only to Germany. But we have not leaders. We have not big companies. And so my industrial policy is to behave coherently with these two, have the skill, the mergers between them, to make these companies fitted for the new globalization. But remember, this is why I am so attentive to Asia, and this may be useful also for your question, U.S. When you have 6 billion consumers and not 1 billion consumers, you are very skilled, small, specialized production, they have room. And so I'm not pessimist for the future of the country, because if we keep this, we have an enormous market. Let's say if you produce pottery tile machinery and you have to feed each year 30 new Chinese factories, well, and you multiply in so many fields, you may have a space in the future of manufacturing. What I'm worried more is services, modern services, finance, communication, and that, in which is much more difficult to find this, let's say, specialized mosaics of our structure. This worries me much more. And then tourism, you know, in which we were dominating and we lost market because we have not, even in this case, if you take the what was the biggest tourist country in the world, we have no hotel, Italian hotel chain. Well, some luxury hotel put together, but in the, let's say, what is the bulk of tourism? There are Spanish, German, French, of course, Americans, but there is no Italian. And this is what I want to do, you know, try to reinforce services, because this will be necessary for our future.
We should not forget that the President of the United States, who takes office on January 20th of 2009, will be flying in an Italian helicopter. Augusta Westland, part of Finmeconica. You can take some pride in that, too. Well, now, we thank you. This, I think you'll agree with me. We've had many heads of government speak to us. I can't think of many who've spoken to us so clearly, on the record, answering the most difficult questions as eloquently, forcefully, and honestly as Romano Prodi. We thank you very much for coming.